I was instructed to offer an integrity perspective on the three studies, which I'll do in a minute. But first I wish to refer specifically to the balancing versus necessity paper. The paper consists of three studies. I'll start with studies 1A and 1B, which were conducted with laypersons, and focus on their comprehension check. Suppose that we use a multiple choice question with four possible options as a comprehension check. Suppose further that 80% of the participants know the correct answer, while the remaining 20% simply make a guess. In that case, since there are four possible answers, one quarter of the guessers are expected to give the correct answer by chance. Consequently, we will see that only 15% did not understand the questionnaire. The 15% figure thus underestimates the true proportion of the guessers, which is actually 20%. Now suppose that we use a binary question, a question with only two possible answers, as our attention check. Suppose further that only one third of the participants know the correct answer, while the remaining two thirds make a guess. In that case, since there are only two possible answers, one half of the guessers will give the correct answer by chance. Consequently, we will see that only one third of the participants fail the attention check, despite the fact that two thirds were simply guessing. This is more or less what happened in studies 1A and 1B. In both studies, almost one third of the participants gave the wrong answer to the binary comprehension question. This means that actually about two thirds of the participants did not understand or did not pay attention to the details. On the one hand, finding statistically significant results in studies where half of the people whose answers were analyzed did not understand the questionnaire is doubly impressive. On the other hand, one might hesitate to rely on a study in which almost two-thirds of the participants might have not understood the questionnaire. Based on my own experience, my advice is to either refrain from asking laypersons about non-trivial legal issues or to make a much greater effort to ensure that they understand those issues. Moving to study 2, the authors examined how presenting participants with either a balancing or a necessity test of proportionality would affect their decision whether to approve a given legislative proposal. The participants were instructed to apply the test described to them, either balancing or necessity, and were told that they would then have to explain their decision based on that test, which they did. Two-thirds of the participants actually gave an explanation that conformed with their condition, while one-third gave an explanation that did not, either relying on the other test, on both tests, or on neither of them. It was found that when participants gave an explanation that conformed with the test presented to them, those in the necessity condition were significantly less inclined to approve the proposal than those in the balancing condition. The authors conclude that compared to the balancing test, the necessity test, and I quote, increases the extent to which rights are protected. I'm afraid that this conclusion cannot be drawn from the findings. The independent variable in study 2 was the formulation of the proportionality test presented to the participants. When examining the association between the condition and the decision, regardless of the ex post explanation, the condition had no significant effect, p equals 0.38. True, when comparing only the participants whose explanations conform with the condition, there was a statistically significant difference, but this result no longer draws on the random allocation of the participants to the two independent conditions. Rather, it depends on the explanation given by the participants after making their decision. In other words, the study did not show any association between the formulation of the proportionality test and the decision, which is not conditioned on the post hoc explanation. Now, the study has found that participants who used the necessity explanation, regardless of which formulation they had been presented with, were less inclined to approve the proposal than those who used the balancing explanation. However, we cannot know what the causal connection was. One possibility is that the decision was a result of the preferred explanation, Another possibility is that the explanation was an ex post justification for the decision. And the third possibility is that the third latent variable influenced both the explanation and the decision. I now turn to general comments on the proportionality test. First, following the study of Statman et al., unreliable protection, I would like to say a word about the incidence of the proportionality test in international humanitarian law. According to the article, existing international humanitarian law differentiates between intended and merely foreseeable harm to civilians during war. Harming civilians as a side effect of attacking military targets is subject to a proportionality test, while intended harming of civilians is absolutely forbidden. If this is indeed the law, and which for all I know it is, this is hardly justifiable, as one can imagine extreme scenarios in which the overall social benefit of targeting innocent people may be large enough to justify such targeting. In fact, empirical studies have shown that while a large minority of people at first express absolutist deontological judgments, once they are asked to imagine more and more extreme scenarios, such as intendedly killing one person in order to save 500, 5,000 or 5 million people, even those people who were initially expressing absolutist deontological responses, very few of them stick to the absolutist position. As Barak Medina and I have argued in our book, Law, Economics and Morality, the net social benefit necessary to justify an intended harming of innocent people is much greater than the net benefit necessary to justify harming as a side effect. But it is not infinite. Some international law experts, such as Professor Gabriela Bloom, have similarly criticized the absolute prohibition of intended harming of innocent people. In fact, even Michael Walzer, who is cited in the article in support of the current position of the law, agrees that there may be cases of supreme emergencies in which civilians may be intendedly harmed. Moreover, to the best of my understanding, this is also the position of Daniel Statman himself, based on the idea of self-defense. My second general comment refers to the vagueness of the proportionality doctrine as demonstrated in all three studies, and most powerfully in the unreliable protection paper. The main finding of the paper is that both academic experts and military officers failed to reach reasonable convergence regarding the maximum number of civilians that may be risked in military operations. The authors conclude that the notion of proportionality fails precisely when it is most needed. Nevertheless, they do not recommend abandoning the proportionality test altogether because it can still provide protection in cases where a large majority of experts would be in agreement. One possibility that none of the three studies consider is to translate the general standard of proportionality into concrete legal rules and even specific numbers. While such concrete rules may still leave some discretion, designing them is not impossible and may be warranted. In other contexts, the law does not content itself with vague standards, but rather lays down concrete rules. For example, courts regularly award monetary damages for loss of limb, and in doing so, they sometimes follow specific concrete rules. Some legal systems also lay down concrete guidelines for the determination of criminal sanctions, including the length of incarceration. In our book, Barak Medina and I recommended to formulate such rules and guidelines, for example, in military manuals. While the pronouncement of such rules by the law may have detrimental expressive effects and other disadvantages, which we discuss in the book, I believe that such rules may be superior to the current situation in which, according to the studies, there are almost no effective norms at all. At the very least, this possibility must be seriously considered. This leads me to my last comment. The proportionality test rejects both purely consequentialist and absolutist deontological reasoning. It rejects the idea that it is permissible to kill 10 innocent people in order to save the lives of 11 innocent people. At the same time, it rejects the idea that the state should never infringe civil or human rights. If this is true, then at least some of the formulations of the proportionality test are problematic. For example, in the facts and preferences paper, the authors write that the proportionality test assigns positive utility to the attainment of the worthy goal and a negative utility to infringement of rights. This formulation sounds as if we are dealing with cost-benefit analysis, comparing positive and negative utilities. Moderate deontological theories and the very notion of human rights are incompatible with a simple cost-benefit analysis or act-consequentialism, as they postulate that there are constraints on maximizing good outcomes. Within a moderate deontological framework, the goal is not merely to maximize overall good outcomes, but to do so subject to constraints. Constraints that may be overcome only if sufficiently large amount of normatively relevant outcomes is at stake. Adding the necessity test, the requirement to prefer measures that infringe human rights to a lesser extent, if such measures are available, does not solve the problem, because even a simple cost-benefit analysis entails such a preference as it produces greater net benefit. In contrast, using the mode of reasoning advanced by moderate deontology, coupled with insights from economic analysis, may add more clarity. Thus, a preferable formulation might be that a right infringement is permissible only if the marginal net benefit of such infringement exceeds a certain threshold. This threshold varies across contexts depending on the type and scope of the right infringement. Such a formulation impliedly embodies the necessity test because we talk about the marginal net benefit taking into account alternative modes of action. A reformulation, or at least a reinterpretation of the proportionality test based on the insights of moderate deontology, may thus be called for. Thank you.